At 13,500 RPM, the green light goes on. You get ready. The second green blinks on at 13,700 RPM. Almost there. Amber at 13,900 RPM. Change. That little sequence takes about half a second. Gradually becoming accustomed to the noise and beginning to feel as though I was controlling the car and not the other way around, I thought how intuitive the driving controls are. Green, green, amber, change. It made me see Paul Ricard from a new vantage point, and the act of piloting a Formula One car from a fresh perspective. I was in my 40s when the bug to actually race, rather than just design the cars, bit deep. But it first nibbled at that moment. It began to rain, chucking it down with rain. I'd started to get a bit cocky, but the combination of inexperienced, but gathering in confidence, driver, and the rain was not a good one. And as my engineer's brain began to think about that redundant left leg and whether it could be positioned differently to allow a narrower and more aerodynamically efficient front to the chassis, I lost a little focus. Before you knew it, I'd spun the FW15. Good thing about Ricard. There are lots of runoffs. You have to be going some to hit anything at Ricard, and I wasn't, so I didn't. And no, I wasn't quick with the clutch, so yes, I stalled it again. There's no onboard starter on the car. If you spin and don't manage to keep the engine running, you have two problems. First, the engine's stopped, so you'll need mechanics armed with a pit starter motor to get back in business. Second, it's stuck in whatever gear you were in at the time. And because the gear shift is hydraulically powered, it's not until the engine is running that you can then go back down through the gears. But of course, the mechanics can't start the car in gear because it would race off away from them. They need to come to the car with a little ratchet spanner and manually rock the car backwards and forwards while working the spanner on the end of the gear shift barrel until it gets back down to neutral. Only then can they put the starter in and restart the car, and off you go again. So, there I waited. After 5 minutes or so, the mechanics arrived in a hire car. This had brightened their day, and yes, I was on the receiving end of some light-hearted banter. When everything was safe, I took off again, clocking up more laps, really getting into it now, feeling a bit more at one with the car. Speeds? Now you're asking. At Monza, cars reach speeds of 220 miles an hour. Me, at Ricard, I got it up to 175 miles an hour that day, which, obviously, is not what Alain Prost or Damon Hill would have settled for in that car, but still, for a 34-year-old engineer on his first outing, it was fast enough. Indeed, by the following June, when I raced the FW15 against Christian Fittipaldi and Martin Brundle up the hill at the Goodwood Festival of Speed, I felt comfortable simply driving it. After all, it's actually relatively easy to drive a Formula One car. Throttle, green, green, amber, change. Brake, turn the wheel, point it at a corner, accelerate. Simple. It's like an arcade game. The challenge is doing it faster than everybody else without losing control. That is an entirely different level. On the grid. Chapter 1. Born in 1958, I came of age in a world infatuated with the motor car. Scalextric, Formula One, the Monte Carlo Rally. At 10 years old, I watched a Lamborghini tumble down a mountainside and Mini Coopers pull off the Italian job. And when Kowalski slapped his Dodge Charger into fifth and accelerated away from the cops in Vanishing Point, I yelled in amazement, "He's got another gear!" and then slid down in my seat as what felt like the whole of the cinema turned to glare at me. I devoured Autosport, the weekly Bible for all things motorsport. I was glued to the radio during the 1968 London to Sydney Marathon. By the age of 6, I decided my future lay in motorsport. I was 12 when I knew I wanted to design racing cars. My passions were forged at home. Situated at the end of a rural lane on the outskirts of Stratford-upon-Avon, our house backed onto a smelly pig farm, and it was from there that my father, Richard, ran a veterinary practice with his business partner.